Miami, swingende kustplaats in de Amerikaanse staat Florida. Maar ook woonplaats voor duizenden gepensioneerde renteniers. Vlak in de buurt gelegen van Cuba. En daarom door de jaren heen toevluchtsoord voor Cubanen die hun land willen verlaten. Zoals in 1959, toen president Batista werd verdreven door Fidel Castro's guerrillabeweging. Te midden van de talloze Cubaanse families die toen hun koffers pakten richting Miami, was ook het gezin Fajardo. Vader, moeder en hun pasgeboren dochter Gloria. Hoe weinig kon dat tweejarig Cubaanse meisje vermoeden dat ze 25 jaar later een wereldberoemd zangeres zou zijn. En dat die muzikale roem uitgerekend in een land als Nederland zou beginnen. Gloria verbaast zich toch over de mensen in ons land.
The statistics are 1 in 10 people have one of my records in Holland, which is amazing. And we did the show. They would sing along every lyric and every song, and I thought I'd surprise them with a very old Spanish song that I thought they'll never know this. And sure enough, you know, they sang it right along with me. So
even the Spanish lyrics.
Even the Spanish lyrics. I don't know if they knew what they were saying, but. They definitely sang it.
Ze woont op een streng bewaakt terrein op een eiland aan de rand van Miami. Het is eigenlijk niet anders dan een wonder dat je haar hier nog aantreft na haar fatale busongeluk van 4 jaar geleden. Een wonder dat ze hier kon terugkeren. Bij haar man, bij haar zoon en bij haar geliefde Dalmatiërs. Wat bleef is die belangrijke rol die ons land speelt in haar muzikale carrière.
The number that meant your final worldwide breakthrough, Conga, started in Utrecht.
It did start in Utrecht. We were in a discotheque there, and Emilio, they said, we want more. We didn't have any more, so we played an old Cuban Conga medley that was in Spanish, and they loved it so much that when we were standing outside, I said to the drummer, you know, we should write an original song based on this beat, and he wrote it going on the plane from Holland to England.
So it's an important country for your career.
Most definitely.
Papa was een geboren militair. Hij vocht in Vietnam, keerde zwaar invalide terug naar zijn vrouw en zijn beide dochters. Oorzaak: het giftige gas Agent Orange dat de Amerikanen toen gebruikten. Gevolg: Gloria kreeg zo jong als ze was de zorg voor vader en voor haar 6 jaar jongere zus. Ze trouwde met bandleider Emilio, ook een Cubaanse immigrant. En ze kregen tot op heden 1 zoon, Najib. Maar tot die tijd werd Gloria's leven bepaald door de militaire ambities van haar vader en door zijn slepende ziekte.
Did he fight for a dream? Did he have a personal dream to do all that?
He had a personal dream of freedom. He was a very idealistic man and probably sacrificed his entire life for that cause. His father was in the Batista's army, and he always wanted to be in the army, but his father wouldn't let him because he said they'd be accused of nepotism. So he joined the police force in Cuba, and he was the motorcycle escort to the First Lady, which was as close as he could get to his military dream. But he was raised in a very military household. His father raised his kids like the military, and he very much enjoyed it. And when Castro took over Cuba, he was very aware of the behind the scenes of what Castro was. So he immediately took us out of Cuba and then joined the resistance.
Aquí la gran cadena de la libertad, transmitiendo desde Cuba, territorio libre de América.
Die vrijheid bleek al snel een illusie. Castro dwong iedere burger, van oud tot zeer jong, om Batista-aanhangers aan te geven die vervolgens werden geëxecuteerd. In menig opzicht was hij veel erger dan zijn voorganger Batista. Gloria's vader bleef dromen van een vrij Cuba en nam in 1961 deel aan de in het geheim door president Kennedy gesteunde invasie in de Varkensbaai, bedoeld om Cuba te bevrijden. Een invasie die uitliep op een mislukking.
Oh, all ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, where they're found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back. I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace.
In onze dagen herhaalde de geschiedenis zich. Afgelopen zomer ontvluchtten bijna 50.000 Cubanen hun land in de hoop op asiel in Amerika. Ze verlieten Cuba vanwege de slechte economische situatie en de honger. Het was een ware exodus, net als 35 jaar geleden, toen de vader van Gloria Estefan zijn Cuba terugtoekeerde.
And then when he came from Cuba to the United States, he joined the US Army because he really loved the military, and then volunteered to Vietnam to fight for freedom because his dream was to one day again return to Cuba with the support of the US, and he thought that he would have to support them in their endeavors.
He hoped that one day the Americans would set Cuba free.
Exactly.
That was his dream.
Exactly, and that's why he volunteered to Vietnam, because he thought that he would support them in their dream of freedom, wherever it might be, wherever he might fight communism, and he volunteered for that reason, because he didn't have to go to Vietnam. He wasn't born here.
He was a victim of this famous gas they used in Vietnam.
Ah, yes, Agent Orange.
Weren't you furious when you heard that?
I couldn't be furious because he was his choice. He wasn't drafted. You know, it wasn't like a young man that's 17 years old that has no choice, that is forced into the army because of the draft, and it's really a very unfair situation. He was a man that wanted to be there, and he chose to be there. So he knew the dangers. Obviously, you know, no one knew the dangers of that particular gas, but so many things happen that way that we find out years later that this is, you know, a bad drug or this is a bad thing. So I really can't be angry because it was his choice.
He lived more than 10 years after that, most of the time as a sick man. Was that a burden for the family?
It was difficult. His illness was definitely a learning experience. And fortunately for me, I tried to get the best positive experience out of everything, no matter how negative. And it taught me a lot of priorities and true values, I think, and what's important in life. But it was very difficult. I was only 12 years old when he became seriously ill. I had to care for him a lot, because my mother worked and I had a younger sister, so it was a lot of responsibility. But in a way, I think it shaped me, and you know, everything that becomes a part of you and hopefully makes you a better person is a good thing. So out of all these horrible things that we go through, you know, you try to get the best that you can.
Yes. Did that go through your mind when you had your own accident, that you didn't want to see the same burden on your own family, probably?
Most definitely. That was a crucial element in the amount of effort that I put forth. Besides being a very independent person, I didn't want to be a burden to my family. I knew what being the victim of that was. And you have no choice, obviously, if that has to happen. But I knew that I was going to give every possible inch of determination and of hard work to try to avoid it. Because if you don't work quickly, I had a very keen knowledge of muscle structure and the spine, and because of everything I went through with my father, I know how quickly muscles atrophy. I know how all these things depend on you, and that was a big motivator for me.
En dan wordt 4 jaar geleden de tourbus van de band van achteren geramd door een vrachtwagen. Als door een wonder overleven Gloria, haar man Emilio en zoontje Najib de klap. Gloria is er het zwaarst aan toe. Zij breekt haar rug. Ze wordt wat je noemt weer in elkaar gezet en ze krijgt heel wat lood en pinnen in haar lijf. Ze moet een jaar revalideren en vreest dan dat ze even door al dat lood op vliegvelden nooit meer probleemloos door de douane zal kunnen. Maar zeer snel daarna is ze alweer in staat om de draad van haar succesvolle leven op te pakken.
Because even the doctors were surprised, not to say amazed, at your rapid recuperation.
They were pretty shocked.
Yeah.
In fact, I remember my doctor that operated on me in New York, he saw the first show in Miami and the last show in New York, and he was crying. He says that he's operated on giant football stars, you know, big men that haven't been able to do the kind of recoup that I did, because he really felt and he saw how badly I was injured. And I think that besides the hard work that I put into it, it had a lot to do with people's prayers and good wishes. I felt them physically around me, and I used them. I think they had a lot to do with my healing process and how I assimilated it and really absorbed it. And all that love was definitely a big help in my recuperation.
Alsof er niks gebeurd is, heeft ze nu weer een nieuwe hit. De titelsong uit de speelfilm The Specialist, met onder andere Sylvester Stallone.
To the nitty-gritty. When you hear the scratch of guitar scratching, well, then you know that rhythm carries all the action. Whoa, yeah.
Turn the beat around.
Turn it around.
At that period of time, you could only dream of walking, that's let alone dream of performing. And now you're pregnant again.
Yes, yes.
Is that the ultimate
tough.
Dream?
That was my ultimate dream because that was our plan. And obviously that had to be postponed because there was no way I could put that kind of pressure on my body. We didn't even know if it could happen. And then eventually when we started trying, we realized that there was a problem. They feel it was due to the accident, but, you know, they fixed it and we went on. And now we're very, very happy, you know. And everything happens, I think, at the right time. I think it couldn't be better timing than right now for this baby.
Is it a secret that it's going to be a daughter or not?
No, it's no secret. Everybody knows. The secret is the name, but now I can tell you we're naming her Emily after her father.
How about
Emilia.
A second name?
We don't know that yet. That's a big dilemma in my family. I wanted to name her after my grandmother. Nobody likes that name, and my mother says my grandmother hated her own name, but to me it's so special, and it's hard, you know. Everybody has an idea. We'll see.
Yeah. So Najib is getting a sister. Najib has been an enormous stimulus in your life in the way you recuperated yourself as well, hasn't he?
Yes, he has. My son has been inspirational to me in so many respects, from even being in the accident and getting through it because he was there with me. And I didn't want him to be traumatized or in shock, so it made me keep more control of myself. To have him there and to know he was safe was a big incentive. And also just throughout my life, I think once you have children, and he's a very special child to me, we're very close. We're enjoying this new event in the family.
The story goes, but it might be a myth, that during the accident you felt Najib's hand in yours.
Oh yes, no, it was true. He held my hand through the entire thing. We couldn't find him immediately after the accident because he had just gone to his bunk in the center of the bus and everything was pitch black because they're like bunks and beds and very dark. And I couldn't hear him, so I was more worried about him. I said to Emilio, you know, find the baby. The baby's so big now. But until I heard him call out to his father, you know, I didn't feel. I was like so scared that something had happened because he was at the actual point of impact where we got hit. And then once he brought him to me, he knew he had a broken collarbone. He held my hand through the whole thing and he kept saying, Mommy, are you all right? Are you okay? You know. And it made me very strong for that moment.
It was the start of your recovery, probably.
Most definitely. Just knowing he was okay, I didn't care about the rest of it at that point.
But nowadays, can you pass unnoticed through customs on an airport or not?
I was always able to. I'm titanium, so I'm non-magnetic. I don't beep at airports in the security. I tested that. But no, I'm very lightweight. I'm cutting-edge technology. You know?
But there's still some steel inside of you.
Not the physical steel, but I think definitely in my emotional and my nerves are much more steel. My back is more titanium. And, you know, the astronauts use that metal, so pretty good.
That accident must have changed your life.
It changed it in some ways. Obviously, such a traumatic event. You can't be the same, it's impossible. It didn't change my values or my priorities in life, but it did give me a very keen sense of enjoyment of every moment, and it brought me more in tune again with my spirituality, because not in a religious sense, because I don't feel any differently that way, but when I was very young, I was very spiritual, and as you get involved in day-to-day activities in life and things, you tend to somehow get caught up in things that have no importance. So It really just threw me back to, I think, our true purpose in being here.
You were raised a Catholic, but young already, you were a very critical Catholic, because you once said that if God has given me brains, he will accept that I ask some critical questions.
You did your homework, didn't you? Yes, it's true. I I think that most definitely we're made in a way to ask questions. And sometimes I think what happens with organized religion, the dogmatic part of it, is that it pulls us away from the questions that really are crucial and that should make a difference in our lives. I can't imagine a God that would punish you and put you in hell the rest of your life for making a mistake that's human, and just things that didn't make sense to me.
But did the nuns at school accept and like your critical attitude?
They actually thought I was going to be a nun. There were some nuns that were very enlightened, and there were some nuns that were very traumatic. You know, some of these nuns made a big impact, but in a way to scare the hell out of me, if you think,
yes.
If I could be blunt. I think a lot of these people are also frustrated people that some joined religion for the wrong reasons, and then we tend to tie these things together. So a lot of people have been traumatized by perhaps people that shouldn't have been in the clergy. On the other hand, there were some very wonderful women that that were very spiritual and had the right idea and were very open-minded. I think we have to grow. I mean, religion has to grow with the times.
You didn't become a nun, but the story goes that you were the last girl from Miami that went into marriage a virgin.
Well, I don't know if I was the last one. It was quite coincidental. It's not anything that was planned, but it did happen that way. I told Emilio, I tell him all the time, you got a good deal. You know, he was my first and only boyfriend. And he says I've gotten better with age, which is very nice and interesting.
Thank you.